Hi guys. So in this series of videos, we are going to talk about the big three, Djokovic, Nadal and Federer, and what is it that makes them such good players, you know, that they are considered, all of those three players are considered to be, you know, the greatest players of all time. And what is it that the younger players are lacking, and what is it that they can do to actually beat these three guys? Okay. And it's a series of videos, so maybe it will be in parts. So today we are going to talk about the qualities of these big three players, okay? And in the next video, we'll talk about the younger players and what is lacking in them, and maybe how we can create a perfect tennis player that can, you know, beat any of the guys. So today let's start off by talking about these three top players. Now, before we start discussing, one question is: a perfect tennis player a myth, or does a perfect tennis player actually exist? At this point, I would say it's a myth, because we cannot say, even though these players are such good players, but we cannot say that they are perfect, because nobody is perfect, and you know, it's going to stay that way. So every player, even if it is Federer or a Nadal or a Djokovic, they have their weaknesses, they have their strengths. It's just that they manage their weaknesses really well, and they know what to use when. So it's a combination of their technical game as well as their mentality, their competitiveness and their strategy at the right time, at the right moment. This is what makes them the best players in the world, and they are the best players in the world, but they are not perfect players. So there is no perfect player in this world. And so we will discuss how one can achieve perfection, or one can try to achieve perfection, and is it really possible? Okay, so first let's talk about these three players, Nadal, Djokovic and Federer. So let's go one by one. So let us start with Federer. So for Federer, I think he has been, you know, playing for a lot of years now, a long time now, and if you see his peak or prime years, those were 2004, 2005, 2006 and 2007 as well. He was playing well, although he was losing some of the matches which he shouldn't have lost, but then also he was playing well. And 2008, once he was, you know, diagnosed with glandular fever, and then he came back from that injury, so he was sort of you know, not at his best. And then from that point on, he has improved his game, he has improved his movement, he has brought a lot of new shots in his game. But then Djokovic and Nadal have been better than him from that point onwards. So for him, if we have to analyze, we have to see the time when he was in his prime for all these players. And that is what we'll be doing. So let us take the Federer of 2006 and 2005, when he was at his absolute prime. So the thing with Federer is that if you talk about his game, okay, we are going to talk about three things here. One is the game, one is the consistency, and one is the mental part of the game. Okay, these three are the categories that we are going to discuss for each of the players. So for Federer, and also the competition, because a lot of you know, people, a lot of critics say that Federer's era was a weak era and stuff like that. So we are also going to address that. So let us start with the part which is the first one, and that is the game. So when you consider the game of Roger Federer, you know, in 2006 and 2005, we can say that his game was near perfect. Okay, if you consider his forehands, even his backhands were really good. He had a very solid backhand, a good slice, good movement, and also a lot of very, very important and accurate first serves at big moments. So when you see his game, you can see US Open matches. There are a lot of matches available on YouTube, so you can see his matches in Wimbledon, in US Open, in Australian Open. You can see one thing to be really common, that he hardly faced any, you know, issues in holding serve. He was really, you know, holding serves very easily. He had a very big first serve. He still has a very big first serve. And he was like that 1-2 punch, he was the master at it. So he would hit a really big serve, and then he would get a short reply, and he'll just finish the point on the net. So that was his, you know, part of the game in terms of his serve. And when he was returning as well, he returned well. So we cannot say that he returned by, you know, hitting a winner, but he would just chip the ball back, and he would just block the ball and get it deep. And once he started off a rally, then he would construct the point very nicely with his ground strokes from both wings, from backhand and forehand, and he would, you know, take the point forward. So game-wise, I would say Federer had the near-perfect game without any weaknesses. Of course, he had a single-handed backhand, but that was really good at that time. It was consistent. And one could not, you know, get to that point because he would always run around his backhand. And he, of course, he was younger, so he could do that more often. And, you know, he could place the ball. He could, he had greater, you know, better reflexes at that time. He was at his peak. He was fitter. So that is why we can say that, you know, his game was near perfect in 2006. Now let's come to the second part. Now second part is the consistency. So consistency wise also Federer was really good. You know, he would come in tournaments after tournaments, whether it is clay or whether it is grass or, you know, hard court. And he would, from the first game onwards, he would, you know, start playing really well. So consistency wise he was really good. It was not like he would be off for one match and then he would, you know, be in form for the second match, or maybe it's some part of the year where he would play well and then some part of the year where he would, you know, struggle. It wasn't like that. He would be consistent throughout the year. He would play most of the matches and most of the big tournaments, and he would win those tournaments. So his record, if you see, is around like, you know, winning 90 matches and losing just 5 or 6 matches for the whole year. Now that is a really, really good record, which is very difficult to break for any of the players. Okay, so consistency wise he was really good. Now let's talk about competition first. So a lot of people, a lot of critics say that you know, Federer played in a weak era. I personally think, in my opinion, that is not a correct statement, because Federer's era was in no way weak. There were a lot of very good players, like, you know, Andy Roddick was there, Marat Safin was there, David Nalbandian was there. And these guys have actually, you know, defeated Djokovic and Nadal in good matches. They have beaten them. But it's just like Nalbandian and every of the other players were getting older, and these players like Nadal and Djokovic were younger at that time and they were getting better. Okay, so we cannot say that it was a weak era. The players were very good, and the conditions were also different. The courts, if you compare to the courts that we have right now, the courts were faster, a lot faster. The ball, the quality of the ball was different. So even the racket technology was different. So the courts were playing really fast, and the players who were aggressive were winning most of the matches, like Andy Roddick, like Marat Safin, that Nalbandian. All of these players were aggressive, okay, and they had great backhands as well as good forehands. Some of the players like Karlovic had, you know, a very big serves, so they were also, you know, progressing. Then there were players like Blake was also a very aggressive player, you know, who used to win some of the matches in those times, who used to, you know, give trouble to Federer in a lot of matches. So then there was Ivan Ljubicic. So a lot of players were there at that time who were, you know, playing well. Then there was a consistent sort of player in Leighton Hewitt who would be really good from the baseline. So I think we cannot say easily that, you know, it was a very weak era or the players were not playing well. It's not a fact. So there were a lot of good players. The conditions were different. Of course, right now, we can say that Djokovic and Nadal are better than Federer at this point of time because of anything. We are not going into the reasons why they are better, but they are better at this point of time, given that, you know, Federer is like 38 years old. So definitely you have to give that, you know, advantage to Nadal and Djokovic. But also there are a lot of other factors. But the bottom line is we cannot say that it was a weak era because of different conditions, different playing styles. Most of the players were aggressive at that point, and Federer was also, you know, playing with them. So I think Federer is the only player actually who had to adjust his game according to the games that the style of game that we have right now with Nadal and Djokovic, and with most of the players very good from the baseline, like Dominic Thiem, Alexander Zverev. So all these good players, you know, play well from the baseline. But Federer, when he started in 2001, 2002, the conditions were different. There were a lot of serve and volley involved, a lot of, you know, just 1-2 punches involved, and, you know, going for the winners and trying to finish the point early. Everybody was, you know, trying to play that sort of a match. So conditions changed, but then Federer also changed his game. He brought a drop shot in his game. He brought more, you know, varied slices in his game. So a lot of things he brought in his game, so it helped him to improve. So competition wise, I think Federer has faced the most adverse competition if you compare with Djokovic and Nadal in terms of competition. And now comes the fourth part, that is the mental strength. So mentally, I would say in terms of strategy and mental strength, I would say Federer is somewhat lesser in than Nadal and Djokovic, because mentally, even if even when he was at his peak, like in 2006 and 2005, there are a lot of matches that he should have won, but he lost. And there are a lot of examples that I can give. Against Nalbandian in the 2005 Shanghai Masters Cup, he was like 30 love up in the final set, although he was love 4 down in the set, and then he came back. But in after that, I think it was 6-5 and 30 love up, and then he lost that game, and he then lost in the tie break. Then it was the Rome final against Nadal in 2006, where Federer had 2 or 3 match points, and he had forehands lined up, and he was just not able to win those points, and he lost in the tie break again. Then he had the French Open of 2006. He started off well, won the first set 6-1, and then when Nadal started being a little aggressive, Federer's game a lot Federer's game got a little passive, and then he lost that match again. And it's there are a lot of matches like this, even in US Open, where he actually won the match. But there are points where he should have won the match earlier, but he made the players get back into the match by losing some crucial points. So mentality wise, I would say Nadal and Djokovic are better in terms of the matches, because if you compare statistics as well, there are a lot of matches where Federer had match points and he lost the match, or Federer had break points, a lot of break points, and he was not able to convert. So the amount of break point conversion, the rate of break point conversion, and the match point conversion is less for Federer as compared to Nadal and Djokovic. And that is why, in comparison with those guys, we can say that Federer is a little bit mentality, game wise, mentality wise, he is a little bit lesser as compared to Nadal and Djokovic. But again, definitely he has a lot of mental strength, and he applies that against any of the other players. But Djokovic and Nadal have given him the most trouble in terms of close matches that he has failed to win. So I think that is all about Federer. Now let's get to Nadal and Djokovic. So let us talk about Nadal first. Now I'll start with competition, because I think Nadal has also faced Federer in his prime, and he has also faced Djokovic in his prime. And I think Nadal, the main point that is his advantage, is his mental strength and his competitiveness. So even though when he came onto the scene, Nadal was really new to hard courts, to grass courts, and he was more comfortable with the clay courts, and he was the king of clay. He was winning there at ease with every player. He was consistently winning clay court tournaments, and there was nobody who could beat him, even Federer. So given that he still wanted to improve on other surfaces, and he really lost. So I don't know if most of you know or not, but Nadal in his earlier years, he lost in US Opens, Australian Opens to aggressive players. Like, he lost in 2007 to Gonzalez, he lost in 2008 to Tsonga, then he lost in 2007 to David Ferrer in the US Open. So, and then he lost to Murray in 2008. So he has lost to different players in these sort of matches in his early years. So what it means is that if the other players would play aggressively, they had a chance to beat Nadal. But the good thing with Nadal is that he kept on improving. He kept on improving to a point that right now we can say he is one of the best players on hard courts and even on grass. So grass was something that was considered that Nadal would find most problems on that surface, but still he played really well. And I think from 2006 to 2010 he was really good. After that, of course, he lost some tricky matches to Dustin Brown, to Nick Kyrgios. But again, for the last 2 or 3 years, if you see, he's losing only to good guys, like to better guys like Djokovic, or to Federer for that matter. And in those years, even when Dustin Brown and Nick Kyrgios were able to beat these guys, they had to play their best to beat Nadal. So it was not like if a surface for Nadal is not that good, so he'll lose in the first round or second round. It's not like that. He'll still play well. So you had to always be on your toes and had to play your perfect game to beat Nadal. So that is the advantage that Nadal has, his competitiveness, his mental strength is immense. And the most important thing with him is that on every important point, whether it is a break point that he has or whether he's down a break point, he is always in charge. He will always play aggressive. He will somehow try to take pace off his first serve and he'll try to get his first serve in. And once he gets his first serve in, with the second shot, he'll try to get it to his forehand and then he'll be really aggressive. Whether it's an off forehand or whether it's a down the line forehand, he will be really aggressive and he will come to the net. He is not afraid to come to the net. Okay, he'll come to the net, he'll finish the point. So it comes under the category of mental strength. Because if you are able to take charge on the biggest of points, no matter who is the opponent, whether it is Federer or Djokovic, Nadal, you can see he's always really aggressive. And I can give you a lot of examples. You can see those matches. The best example is 2013 French Open semi-final against Djokovic. In the final set, Nadal was almost down and out. He was 2 love down. He was 2 love and 30 all or something. He was going to go a double breakdown in the final set. But post that, he played really aggressive. He just hit winners all over the court from that point onwards. And in the end, he, went up winning that match. And then in the final, he went on to beat David Ferrer. So if I really, urge you to see that match, see that final set to understand how Nadal changed it around. Okay. And he has done a lot of times. He has done that a lot of times. So whenever he faces trouble, he gets really aggressive. And it's not a sort of aggressive where he just wants to finish the point early. It's not like that. But he wants to be in control of the point. So being control of a point and being, just trying to finish the point early is a different thing. An example I can give you is of Federer. So when Federer, a lot of times when he plays Nadal and when he faces a pressure point, a lot of time he, tries to finish the point too early, too quickly. And that's when he loses that point. So if you see 2009 Australian Open final against Nadal, you can see when he's love 40 or 15 40 down, he'll just serve on the middle of the court and he'll just come forward. Okay. On an average approach shot, he'll just come forward because he wants to finish that point early. He wants to ask the question to Nadal if you can hit a winner. And more often than not, Nadal is able to hit a passing shot and he wins the match, he wins the point. So the point here is that Federer tries to finish the point very quickly if it is a big point against Nadal or Djokovic. And on the other hand, if it is any other player, he tries to rally with them. He tries to, make them make a mistake. He tries to hit more shots and try to construct a point. But with Nadal and Djokovic, it's different. They will always try to take charge of the point, be really aggressive, and come to the net when required. So they will not just run into the net that easy, but they would come to the net when required. And that is a very, very important factor when you see, Nadal and Djokovic and Federer. And so now let's talk about game. So Nadal's game is perfect. I would not compare it with Federer's game because I think Federer's game when he's playing well is near perfect tennis. Okay. But in terms of game, Nadal doesn't have any weakness. Okay, we can say that his first serve is not that good. So that is probably the most that the other players can exploit. But backhand wise also, I think his backhand is pretty solid. His passing shots are one of the best and his forehand is lethal. Okay. So when he is down or maybe when he's not playing well, his forehand down the line doesn't work. And that is the, point where people can exploit, the other players can exploit that shot because when his forehand down the line is not working, he more often than not will go hit his forehand, cross court. And then you can open up the court if you are a Djokovic or you are a player with a good backhand, you can take advantage of that. But if you yourself don't have a good backhand, then it's really difficult to beat Nadal at any stage of the game, at any court, on any court, at any surface. Okay. So game wise, I think Nadal has a very good game. Only the first serve is the liability if there is one. Then talking about his mental strength, we have already talked about that, and then his strategy. So Nadal, I think, is the most clever player that we have on tour. So he's the player with that sort of attitude that no matter what he has to do, what he needs to do, he wants to win the match anyhow. And that is the quality that separates him from any of the other players on tour. Because you can see Djokovic sometimes frustrated, shouting at his box, shouting at his coaches, discussing with the umpires, fighting with the umpires and all. But you rarely see Nadal do that. Even if he's 1-5 down, he's 2 sets to love down, still you can see fist pumps from Nadal. You can see Nadal, trying to cheer himself up, trying to, let himself, get going by winning a game, by serving well. And it seems like it gives him a lot of energy when he's down. He just, uses that, he summons that energy inside himself and he tries to play better. But the other players, when they go down, they sort of go down in a patch. Like if they are not playing well, they will not play well for like 3 games, 4 games, and then the opponent has a lot of chances. But with Nadal, he will give you 1 or 2 games, but then he'll be really solid from then on. And it's like people are not able, opponents are not able to digest it. That he was, I mean, he's not supposed to play that well. He was just down and out a couple of games back, and now he's just coming back like he was playing, perfectly from the starting. So this is the difference that Nadal, brings to the court. So we one, knows that very well, that if you are able to beat Nadal on any surface, then you have to praise yourself more than anything, because beating Nadal is one of the biggest things, toughest things to do on a tennis court. Because no matter how bad he's playing, no matter how off a day he is having, still he will always give 110% to win the match. And to beat that person, beat any court, is a very big achievement. So all those players who have actually been able to beat Nadal at any point in their careers, it's really, a big achievement for them, because Nadal is somebody who doesn't give away a match even if he's playing bad. And he can do anything, he can go to any extent to win the match. He can use slices if that's what's working, he can use second serves if that's what's working. If his forehand is not working, he will try to hit slices from the forehand. He's such a clever player that he understands, and he is able to adjust those points within a match. Okay, so if he plays a set badly, immediately he comes to know that, okay, this is what I have been doing badly and I have to correct on these points. And you can see the change in the second set. So when you saw the first set, for example, you saw US Open 2017. So you saw his match against Del Potro. He lost the first set, and then he quickly realized that, okay, maybe I'm going too much onto the Del Potro's backhand, so I need to stop it. I need to be really aggressive and go to his forehand as well, just change up a little bit. And also, not only his shots, also his serve. And that's what he did. So you can see the result. He won the second set 6-1 or something. Then he again won the third set 6-2, and the match was over. And Del Potro would be thinking like, I was winning the first set, I was feeling good about my game, and what happened? So Nadal is the player who just comes back like that. Okay, so he can change his strategy within the match very quickly, and he can stick to that winning strategy once he gets it. So that is the talk that we had about Nadal. Now moving on to Novak Djokovic. So Djokovic is also a very good player in terms of, let's talk about mental strength. So mental strength wise, he is also a very solid player, especially when he's down match points. We have seen that in the past, that he usually wins the match when he's down match points, and he plays really aggressive on match points. Okay, yeah, he saved like 4 or 5 match points against Tsonga in one of the French Opens. I don't remember the year, but he played really aggressive and the whole crowd was against him. Tsonga had match points and multiple match points, and Djokovic was laughing, and that's his quality. He just laughs and then he wins the match somehow. So that is his strength. And in terms of playing solid, if you see his tiebreak record and the games that are really important, he never loses those games. He never loses those tie breaks. He plays a really solid game. He hits good backhands, especially his backhand down the line is very important shot for him, and he plays solid. And the other thing that he has is change. So he changes strategy when he's down match points or break points. A lot of times he will, serve and volley on the second serve, which he rarely does, but he will do it when he's facing a break point just to change things up. And it helps. Sometimes the opponents, are not expecting it, and they usually make an error returning the ball, or they just chip the ball straight to him for an easy volley. So in terms of mental strength, I can say that Djokovic is really good. He's really very tough. He's an equivalent to Nadal. You can watch his matches against Nadal in Australian Open 2012, French Open 2013, even US Open matches. There are a lot of matches where they have both gone strength to strength in terms of mentality. And actually, there have been matches where Nadal and Djokovic have looked to be playing at their respective peaks. And there is no player, with Federer, when he plays at his peak, most of the time he wins. Okay. But he doesn't do that often now. In 2005 and 2006, he was at his prime, so more often than not, he will be playing really well. But right now, due to a lot of factors, right now it's like, some days he'll be really good, some days he won't play well. But with Nadal and Djokovic, even if they are not playing well, they try to somehow, find a way to win the match. And it's not like Federer doesn't do that, but it's like Nadal and Djokovic have been able to do that against each other as well as against Federer. So that is the difference, I would say. So all these three players, and now talking about the game of Djokovic. So I think Djokovic also has a very good game, a very nice game, and he has a good backhand, good forehand. His serve was a liability previously, but for the last few years, his serve has been really an improved serve and a very good weapon as of now. Plus, he has also improved his volleys. So I think Djokovic, in terms of his game, is really good, and his mental strength is also very good. So, and of talking about the movement, apart from clay, I think Djokovic has one of the best movements in the game. On the clay, I don't know what is the issue, but sometimes he does appear to struggle on in the movements, struggle in the sliding. He slips a lot, stuff like that. But on the hard courts, I think he's the best mover on a hard court, and even in Wimbledon, he's the best mover in Wimbledon because he slides on the Wimbledon court, which is really difficult to do, and I think that is what has helped him to win so many Wimbledons. Even though he's not, inherently a really aggressive player, he likes to play from the baseline, but still he has won a lot of Wimbledons. He has beaten Federer a lot of times there. Even Nadal, he has beaten there a lot of times. So that is because of his movement, and of course because of his good backhand that he's able to control the ball and change the directions. So guys, this is what I wanted to talk about in terms of Federer, Nadal and Djokovic in terms of their game. Now in the next video, we'll talk about the younger generation and also talk about how they can improve to actually beat these guys in Grand Slams and maybe win a Grand Slam. Okay, so thanks for watching.